Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. So, Mary is a central figure in the life of Jesus as his mother, and she should be a very central figure in our life as Christians, as followers of the Lord Jesus. As Catholics, we should be very proud of our relationship with the Blessed Virgin Mary, because we have a mother. We are not without a mother. When we traveled to Poland on the pilgrimage that I did at the end of October, early November, we went to a couple different Marian shrines. One of them is the shrine of Our Lady of Częstochowa. And we can pass this around. There's also a book going around, a photo album from our pilgrimage. And when we arrived at the first Marian shrine that we went to, the shrine of Our Lady, Queen of the Families, the priest who greeted us, he said, "You know, you feel like you're coming to a strange place because you're in a foreign country. But you're not in a foreign place, because how can you be in a strange place? You have come to your mother's house. You're not in a foreign place. Whenever you're in your mom's house, you're always home." So it was a very warm, warm greeting for us. And Mary is so very special to us because she is special to her son, Jesus. Mary, of course, is not God. We do not worship Mary as Catholics. We do not adore Mary. We venerate her. The word for the veneration that Mary receives is called dulia. It's the highest form of veneration. Veneration is another way of saying respect. So we respect the Virgin Mary because we want to have a mother. Having a mother is so special that even God wished to have a mother. Even God wanted to have a mom. So it's so very special. And so we do not have a right as followers of the Lord Jesus to have an orphan mentality, because we have a mother. We are not orphans. And those who do not want to have Mary as their mom can have her as a mother-in-law. If you don't want Mary as a mother, you can have her as a mother-in-law. I prefer to have her as a mother. It's extremely important for us to get that. So, as Catholics, we do not pray to Mary. If you're praying to Mary, you have to stop that. It's a sin, because you only pray to God. God is the only one who answers our prayers. There are some Catholics who do that because they're ignorant. Don't be ignorant in your faith. You only pray to God. When we say the Hail Mary, we say, Holy Mary, Mother of God. Let's say that together. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. We don't say, Holy Mary, Mother of God, hear our prayer, because the only one who hears our prayers is God. Mary does not grant us miracles. She's not a miracle worker. Neither are any of the other saints. God is the only one responsible for miracles in our lives. The saints and Mary pray for us. What does that mean? Well, if I can ask any of you to pray for me, you have no problem in asking people to pray for you. And those of your friends who are not Catholic also will tell you they have no problem in praying for you. Well, what's the big deal? Why can't I ask Mary to pray for me? That's all we do as Catholics. We ask Mary to pray for us. Now, there's something different. Her prayers are much more powerful than the prayers of any of us because she is the Mother of God. So her prayers are that much more special. And we know that Jesus listens to her because she is his mother. How do we know that? Well, we know that from the Bible. The very first miracle Jesus worked was at a wedding. And you're all familiar with that because Jesus turned water into wine at the wedding feast of Cana. In that culture, if you know something about Middle Eastern culture, the worst thing is shame. Shame is the worst fear that people live with. They're more afraid of shame than of death or sickness. Shame. That is why if a girl today in Middle Eastern culture, in, for example, Muslim countries, you all know that, if she shames her family by, for example, marrying someone that her parents do not agree with, or has sex outside of marriage, what do they do with the girl? They kill her. You know that. That even happens in this country. Girls who have Muslim parents or Middle Eastern parents, because sometimes it's not just Muslims, there are Christians who are from that particular culture who do the very same thing. If a girl shames her family, she's not just disowned, but she is also killed. And it's not just girls, it happens to young men as well. It happens to women who may be caught in adultery. Shame is a horrible thing. So this is how you should understand the wedding feast of Cana. Because what happens there is that the family is shamed or about to be shamed. Because they're running out of wine. And in that culture, when you put on a party, you better not run out of wine. It's like in Poland, where I come from. If you're going to have a party, you better have enough vodka. And those who went with me know that, you know, there was vodka and vodka and vodka. And we were being told over and over again, you know, that we're running out. And we never ran out. Ever. You never run out of vodka. It's the same thing in Middle Eastern culture. You're never supposed to run out of wine when you have a party. And so Mary knows that because she's a Middle Eastern woman. Mary was a Palestinian. She knew that. Jewish, from Palestine. She knew the culture. And what happens? Jesus is having a good time at the party. Because Jesus loved to party. We know that. Why do you think he ended his life with another party? He chose to end his life here on earth with a party as well. The Holy Eucharist. That's why Mass is supposed to be a celebration. Not supposed to be somber. Not supposed to come to Mass and fall asleep. You don't sleep at parties, at least I hope you don't. You know, Jesus was not a party pooper. He loved to party. And he was having a good time at this wedding. And what happens? They run out of wine, or they're running out of wine. Although I think they actually ran out of wine, probably. And the bomb is about to explode at the party. And who do the people turn to for help? They turn to Mary. They say, we ran out of wine. And Mary turns to the waiters and says, do whatever Jesus tells you. She goes to Jesus and she says, they've run out of wine, because Mary can't do the miracle. Only Jesus can, because Jesus is God. Do you understand that? You need to understand that. Mary couldn't do anything. She can't do anything without her son Jesus. So she turns to Jesus and she says, listen, they've run out of wine. Help them. And Jesus is having a good time. That's why he says to her, leave me alone. What do I have to do with this woman? Can you imagine calling your mama woman? Can you imagine going up to your mama and saying, woman? She'd slap you. That's what would happen. Well, Mary knows that Jesus is going to do what she asks for. That's why she turns to the waiter and says, do whatever he says. And Jesus does. Because Mary asks him. Because she's his mama. So do you know who your mama is? Or is she your mother-in-law? I prefer to have Mary as my mother. Somebody I can always turn to for help. And she is, the church calls her the model of our faith. The model of discipleship. Discipleship is our walk with the Lord, because we're all disciples of Jesus. And she is the model of discipleship. A special model of discipleship for us, of how we are supposed to behave. And so let's examine what happened to Mary in her life. The birth of Jesus is announced to Mary. We call this the Annunciation, when the angel comes and tells Mary that she's going to be the mother of Jesus. And here's what happens. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to a town in Galilee named Nazareth. He had a message for a young woman promised in marriage to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of King David, because the Messiah is supposed to come from the line of David. You know that. And if you know something about King David, David was someone who, even though he made a lot of mistakes in his life, turned his life around and trusted in God. That's why he became King David. Not because he was perfect, but because he trusted in God. Her name was Mary. What does the word Mary mean? Mary is a Hebrew word. Those of you who are named Mary, you're going to like this. Because Mary, the word Mary, is a Hebrew word. Now, I'm not talking about Miriam or some other variation of Mary. I'm just talking about Mary. The word Mary in Hebrew means struggle. Struggle. Because Mary's life was a struggle. life was a struggle. Now, are you getting this? The church says that she is our model of discipleship. And if her life was a struggle, and you're supposed to model your life after hers, what makes you think yours isn't going to be a struggle? Our life is a struggle as disciples. And the angel came to her and said, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you. May you be in peace, Mary. The Lord is with you and has greatly blessed you." Even though your life is going to be a struggle, you're going to be okay, Mary, because the Lord is with you and He has blessed you. Mary was deeply troubled by the angel's message, and she wondered what his words meant. You're troubled too all the time in your own life as you struggle, as you are Mary. You are Mary in this life. Not Jesus, because Jesus was without sin, as was Mary. But Mary was a human being like us in all things. Mary knows the struggle. To struggle is not sin. To have doubts is not sinful. So if you have doubts, she had doubts too. If it was all going to be okay. It's okay to have doubts. Nothing wrong with that. It's okay to be troubled. That's exactly what Our Father, when we pray, "Lead us not into temptation," it's the trouble. Don't allow us to be tempted, Lord. The temptation in this life is to feel like God is not with me. That is the temptation. Mary was deeply troubled, and that's why the angel had to come to her and tell her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. God has been gracious to you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High God. The Lord God will make him a king, as his ancestor David was, and he will be the king of the descendants of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Now, let's focus on something here. A lot of you, during the Christmas season, you're all focused on the birth of Jesus. And you are conditioned to believe and to think that the birth of Jesus is a miracle. You think that the birth of Jesus is a miracle. The birth of Jesus is not a miracle. Nothing miraculous about Jesus' birth. It's natural. There's nothing miraculous about Jesus' birth. Mary gave birth in a stable, in a manger, naturally. She was pregnant. What do people do when they're pregnant? Well, nowadays, you know, some people go to Planned Parenthood and abort. But the natural thing to do is to give birth. So there's nothing miraculous about the birth of Jesus. The miracle is the conception. That is the miracle, not the birth. There is nothing miraculous about the birth of Jesus. The miracle is in the conception, because she was a virgin and she conceived through the power of the Holy Spirit. Mary said, "How can this be? I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and God's power will rest upon you." The conception. Do you understand this? In other words, the miracle is the possibility, not the birth of the possibility. The conception depended on God. That is why it was a miracle. The birth depended on Mary, and that's not a miracle. In your life, the same thing. The conception is there. The conception came upon Mary through the power of the Holy Spirit. The possibility of something to be born came upon her and entered her through the power of the Holy Spirit. The birth, the giving of the birth to the possibility, making the possibility a reality, depended on Mary. In other words, the Holy Spirit has come upon you and has given you the possibility. It depends on you whether that possibility becomes a reality. That's on you. In other words, you've got the possibility to be different. The possibility to be different exists in you because you have received the Holy Spirit. He has impregnated you with possibility to quit going to the casino, to quit drinking, to get out of depression, to find yourself a man, to stop being lonely, to get out of your anxiety, to become a different person, to become a better wife, to stop gossiping. All of those possibilities exist in you. To lose weight, to get your health in order, get your house in order. The possibility exists in you, ladies, to finally start cooking meals for your husband. The possibility is there for you to become a better wife, to clean your house. The possibility is there. Those possibilities are there to become a better husband. All those possibilities are there to finally get over those things that are keeping you from becoming the person God wants you to be. The possibility is there to become a different person. God's action in our lives requires our participation. Now, I got to tell you something else about this whole thing. Remember, it says here, Mary said to the angel, "I am a virgin." Okay? I am a virgin. Now, what does that mean? We're not talking here about olive oil. Okay? Right? Let me explain to you what being a virgin means. I'm sure you all need an explanation, okay? But now, I know you're all going into the gutter and thinking, right? Obviously, because you're trained like that in the world, right? That virgin means that she has had no sex. That's what you're thinking of. But virgin, this is a different culture here. Virgin wasn't about not having sex with a man. Virgin in this culture is about preservation, being preserved, kept, being kept, preserved, guarded. In other words, you are Mary. She's our model of discipleship. You are a virgin. You are a virgin because you are preserved. God has been preserving you for something great. Do you understand that? God is preserving you for something great. That's why he has impregnated you, as he's preserved you and wants you to give birth to the possibility that already exists in you. You are a virgin. You have the possibility. It's up to you whether that possibility will become a reality. The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you and God's power will rest on you." Do you believe that? That God's power is with you? Why would you be afraid? You know, maybe you need to make some medical decisions. Have your hip replaced, your knee replaced. What is it? What, some other matter? Maybe you need to start getting on that depression medication to balance your chemicals. You know, why are you so afraid? You know, maybe you need counseling. The Holy Spirit rests upon you. You know, maybe you finally need to step out and, you know, all those guys that you've been checking out on Match.com or CatholicMatch.com, reach out to them, respond to them. Go out, you know. The Holy Spirit is upon you. You've got the possibility. For this reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. And here's the other part here. And remember your relative Elizabeth. It is said that she cannot have children because of her old age. But she herself is now 6 months pregnant, even though she is very old. God is so good to all of us. He's so good to us. Because you live with doubts. You know, and you say to yourself, okay, I'm a virgin. I have the possibility. But the birth, it ain't gonna happen. I just have such a hard time believing that I'm actually pregnant. Such a hard time believing that I'm actually pregnant. And God is so good to us that he says, go to Elizabeth. Go to Elizabeth. In other words, let me show you. That which was impossible has already happened. In the same way, the impossible can happen in your life as well. That's why, see, Mary is like us, full of doubts. You think to yourself, how can this happen? I've been single for the last 20 years. And I have dated all these jerks. There's no way that I'm going to meet somebody. That's the same thing Mary was feeling. How can this be? Come on now, what are you talking about? Pregnant? I haven't had sex. Even I know that can't be. As holy as I am, right? Mary said. She didn't say that to herself because that would be pride. And that is a sin. But do you understand what was going through her head? I'm trying to explain this to you. And God loves her so much as God loves you. That he says, go. That which is impossible has already happened. And that which is impossible can also happen in your life. Go. Look what happened to Elizabeth. In the same way, God is good to you. Your Elizabeth moment is right now. Your Elizabeth moment is right now. Look at this. I'm going to show this to you. The angel says to her, for there is nothing that God cannot do. Nothing is impossible for God. This is your Elizabeth moment. And Mary says, I am the servant of the Lord. May it be done to me as the word of the Lord has said. And the angel left her. And what did Mary do? Soon afterward, Mary got ready, got up, and hurried off to a town in the hill country of Judea. What does Judea mean? The word Judea or Judah. It means praise. Where are you right now? You're in a house of prayer, a house of praise. You're in Judea. You're in Judah. And just like Mary, you've gone through a hill country, haven't you? A lot of stuff that didn't want you to be here today. Well, there's a lot of hill country that you have to go through in order to get here. A lot of rocks. What else is in the hill country? In order to go and be filled with faith and have proved to you that the impossible can happen, there's a lot of obstacles. Your family members. Oh, in the hill country, she was going through the desert. There's a lot of snakes, poisonous snakes, scorpions, desert, rocks. Ooh, she went through the hill country and she got to Judea to see the impossible happen. Isn't that in your life as well? You have to see that the impossible has already happened. Elizabeth, who couldn't get pregnant, is pregnant. She's old. She's past her time. Her cycle is over. And she got pregnant. You can get pregnant too. You can get pregnant too when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And she gave birth. So will you. Monday night, this past Monday, I had a prayer group meeting here. And I was speaking about the very same subject. And at the end of the prayer meeting, Karina comes up to me. Karina, 10 years ago, had her tubes tied, as a lot of people do today. They get their tubes tied because, you know, we're conditioned to think that, you can only have one or two kids. At the most, but preferably don't have any children, Get a cat, or get a dog, okay? Then you have a big house, no kids, just a cat and a dog. That's the society we live in. And that's the death of the West. That's why this is the result of the death of the West. This is precisely what the Roman Catholic Church has been preaching for the last 50 years, ever since 1968, when the Church declared in a powerful document called Humana Vitae what will happen to Western society, and the results of which are shown in Europe. No children. You see, we don't have to be conquered by Muslims. We're already conquered in the West, in Europe. 30% of the population of France is now Muslim. 30%. And they have a lot of children. Catholic churches are being turned into mosques. And this is just France. I could go down the list. That is why in my own country, in Poland, the government has gotten smart and is paying people to have kids. That's why most of my relatives are now pregnant. And so Karina comes to me because 10 years ago she had her tubes tied, which is, as she says, it's a terrible mistake. And it can be reversed, but it's a medical procedure that also costs a lot of money, and can't be all that successful many times. It's another thing to reverse vasectomies on men. That is easier to do than to reverse tubal ligations in women. And she says, but I would like to have a baby. You know, it's a natural thing for women to have kids. And especially in families. Families are supposed to have children. It's one of the most painful things I encounter as a priest is a couple who cannot have kids. The pain is unbearable. Many times they even separate. And so she says, can you say a prayer over me? And I put my hands on her head, invoked the Holy Spirit upon her, prayed for her. And this was 2 months ago, she says. And I remember praying for her, invoking the Holy Spirit over her. And Monday night, Karina says, Father, I am pregnant. I had my appointment with my gynecologist today, and she comes with the ultrasound picture. For nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. And nothing is impossible for God. See, a lot of you're thinking to yourself, well, you know, they probably didn't do it right. It's because of your lack of faith. If you only had the faith of a mustard seed, you could tell a mountain, move, and the mountain would move. That's what the Bible says. Because the world has conditioned you to be incredulous, unbelieving. What is your dream? Mary received the news through an angel. What is yours? What is the news? What is it that you need to get pregnant with in your life? The Holy Spirit is here. You've gone through that hill country. You've arrived in Judah. You're in Judah right now. The Lord is speaking to you. What is it that you need to be pregnant with? Is it the sickness of a loved one? Your own health issues? The need to forgive, to let go? What is it that you're needing in your life? I have seen everything as a priest, including the dead rise. It's a story I will tell you another time. I've seen incredible things. Babies about to die that miraculously are now alive and healthy and no neurological issues. Babies less than a pound. A young 16-year-old young man, Manuel, his family comes to church here. When I was still at St. Joseph, Husband of Mary Parish, they got a hold of me. Somehow I don't remember how they got a hold of me to go to UNC. One of the most powerful cases of the impossible coming true. He tried to commit suicide. He got his parents' gun and put a bullet through his head, and he ended up at the ICU at UNC. And they called me, and The mother was there with me. They only allowed the mom to be there with me as I was giving him the last rites. And I said to her, I said, you know, I'm giving him absolution for his sins. So when he dies, he's going to go straight to heaven. And at that moment, when I said, when he dies, he's going to go straight to heaven, she screamed and said, my baby's going to live. He's not going to die. And against all odds, he was on a respirator, put a bullet through his head. Against all odds, Manny is now a 17-year-old young man. And I just got the news that his girlfriend is pregnant. So he's very fine. Very fine. He's a teenager. In the United States of America. Shouldn't surprise you too much. And these moments God places in my life to reinstill my own faith. Because let me tell you, when I was in that hospital, I was giving this young man his last rites and sending him to the other side. And my next conversation was going to be about his funeral mass. Because that's my humanity. That's the same thing that happens in your life. When you look at the impossible situations that you face in your own life, you're preparing the funeral. Your mother is there with you. And as much as you may not be praying for yourself, and as incredulous as you may get, and as unbelieving as you may become, the faith of Mary is present there. And she's praying for you. She's rooting for you. Her faith is there. She's by your side. She went into Zachariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby moved within her. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and said in a loud voice, how blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does it happen to me that the mother of my Lord comes to visit me? For as soon as I heard your greeting, the baby within me jumped with gladness. How happy you are, O Mary, to believe that the Lord's message to you will come true. How happy all of us should be today that the mother of our Lord has come to greet us, to say to us that we too are impregnated with possibility, and that the birth of that possibility is up to us. For that birth to come true. How blessed are you, O Mary, among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. So how does it happen that the mother of my Lord has come to greet me? It has happened because of God's great love for you. You who have gone through the hill country and have arrived in Judah. You, Mary, you struggle. Keep struggling on as you go through the hill country to Judah. The most powerful line, I think, of all scripture for us is not John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. I think the most powerful line of all of scripture is this one. For nothing is impossible for God. That's faith. Luke 1, verse 37. There is nothing that God cannot do. Even impregnate you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we thank you, Lord, for this morning. As you have come to impregnate us with possibility. You have come to give us the possibility. And so we want to, Lord, today open up our legs and give birth to that possibility in our life. Give birth to that possibility through the power of the Holy Spirit. That just as that Holy Spirit came upon Mary, it comes upon us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And may the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you.